Hello, my name is Trevor Johns, and I'm a software engineer from the Google Data APIs team. The Google Data APIs allow you to programmatically access various Google services such as Blogger, Google Calendar, your Gmail contacts list, or even YouTube. I'm here today to help you get started interacting with these APIs from within your PHP applications. This video assumes that you're already familiar with the basics of web development in PHP. It'll also help if you had past experience working with web services, though this isn't strictly required. Before we begin, you'll need three things: an HTTP server, PHP, and the PHP Google Data Client Library. I'll go through each of these briefly. Most hosting providers already provide an HTTP server and PHP, but if you haven't already done so, I highly recommend installing a copy locally for development purposes. Any HTTP server will do, provided that it supports executing PHP scripts. I recommend using the Apache HTTP server, which can be downloaded from httpd.apache.org. Once your HTTP server is installed, you can download PHP from php.net. OS-specific installation instructions are posted on each of these sites. While installing Apache and PHP are outside the scope of this video, I'll show you how to quickly check to see if your installation is properly set up. Simply create a file that contains these two lines. The first is just the standard PHP start tag, and the second is the PHP info function, which if you've done PHP development before, you might know that it goes and displays information about your PHP environment. If we save this within our web root as, say, info.php, and then load it within our browser, it should show information about your PHP installation, such as the version, any build commands used, what your include path is. If you don't get this page, and instead you just get the contents of the info.php file you just saved, then you know something's wrong and you'll need to troubleshoot. Once you have your HTTP server installed and running with PHP support, it's time to download the PHP Google Data Client Library. This is distributed as part of the Zen Framework open source project, available at framework.zen.com. Zen Framework includes a lot of components besides just what's needed for accessing the Google Data APIs, so if you don't want all the overhead of Zen Framework, or already using another web development toolkit, you can download a lightweight, Google-only version of Zen Framework by going to framework.zen.com/download/gdata. To demonstrate, I'll quickly go through the Zen Framework installation process. So I'm just going to go ahead and open up a browser and go to framework.zen.com/download/gdata and grab the tarball from the latest release. Once it finishes downloading, I'm just going to go ahead and extract it. Once this is done, place the resulting folder somewhere safe and accessible to your web server. Since on my system both Apache and PHP are installed in opt-local, I'm going to go ahead and place it there as well. On your system, you'll probably want to put it somewhere else. Finally, you'll need to tell PHP where to find Zen Framework. The best way to do this is to modify your php.ini file. On my system, this is located in opt-local etc because I installed PHP into opt-local. However, depending on how you've installed PHP, it may be located in another location, such as user local etc or c:\php if you're on Windows. So I'm going to go ahead and open this up in a text editor. And find the line that begins with include path. This is a colon-separated list of various directories that PHP is going to search when it's looking up libraries. I'm just going to go ahead and add the path where I stored zen-gdata, so opt-local zen-gdata, followed by /library. Now that I've updated my PHP ini, I just need to restart Apache so that PHP can pick up the new changes. So I'm just going to go ahead and run Apache control restart, and then it should be good to go. So I'm just going to go ahead and load php-a to get an interactive PHP session. And I'm going to try and load a file from Zen Framework. I'm going to load zen-loader.php, which should be there. If you don't get any errors, then everything's good to go. If not, then you know you need to troubleshoot. A good place to check if this happens is to look at the info.php file we created earlier. This will show you the include path that's currently in effect. So if this is wrong, make sure that you've edited the correct php.ini file and that the path you listed is actually correct. If you're deploying to manage hosting, you might not have direct access to your PHP ini file. If your hosting provider has allowed it, and if your hosting provider is using Apache with mod PHP, you can instead set PHP's configuration settings using a htaccess file. So to do this, go ahead and create a new file. And then type the line php underscore value, include path, and then in parentheses, the path to your Zen GData folder followed by slash library. Then save this in your web root as .htaccessed, and save it. I'm not going to actually save it because I've already edited my PHP ini, but otherwise this should work. Now the Zen framework is installed, let's take a brief tour of the client library. A useful page for this is the Zen framework API reference available at framework.zen.com/api-doc/core. Let's go there now. Click on Zen GData in the upper right-hand corner to switch to make that the active package. And then you'll notice on the left, there's a list of classes within Zen GData. There's five main types of classes that you'll normally be interacting with. Service classes, query classes, feeds, entries, and extension elements. Zen GData is an example of a service class. Service classes are the heart of the client library and serve to manage access to Google services over the network. Zen GData is a generic service class used for Blogger. Most other services have a dedicated service class, such as Zen GData YouTube. Query classes contain knowledge about the address scheme used for the various services and are used to assist in forming URLs. You can either allow the query object to create a URL for you or just pass the URL into the query yourself if you know it. As before, Zen GData Query is a generic query class, though many services have specialized query classes, such as Zen GData YouTube. Feeds are returned by service classes in response to a network request, often using the help of a query. Feeds are simply a collection of entry objects along with a small bit of metadata to describe the collection. Zen GData Feed is an example of this, and there's many subclasses used for the various services. Entries, as the name suggests, represent a logical collection of data about something. This might be a blog post, or a contact, or a calendar event. These are represented by Zen GData Entry, and like Zen GData Feed, there's many subclasses used by each of the services. Finally, inside of entries and feeds, extension elements are used to represent individual pieces of data. For example, this might be the owner of a blog, the title of a post, or the date of a calendar event. These are represented by subclasses of Zen GData App Extension. Now that you're familiar with the library, we're going to write a quick program to create and display posts from Blogger. Let's get started. So to begin, I'm going to go and create a brand new HTML file. I'll go ahead and call this Blogger PHP Demo. And I'll go ahead and put a nice title at the top of the page. And then I'm just going to go ahead and save this as blogger.php inside of my web root. At the very top, I'll go ahead and insert a block of PHP code to load in Zen GData libraries. The very first thing you should always load when using Zen Framework is zenloader.php. You can then use ZenLoader to load in any other dependencies you have. In this case, we're using Zen GData, Zen GData Query, and Zen GData Client Login. Zen GData and Zen GData Query, I discussed earlier, Zen GData Client Login is used to go and authenticate to Blogger. So once that's in place, I'll just go down here to the body, create another block of PHP code, and authenticate to Blogger. So again, we're using Client Login to actually authenticate. Some other options you might want to use here are AuthSub and OAuth, which allow you to go and log in without ever actually seeing the user's password, which is really great for web apps since it protects the user's security. Once that's done, we create an instance of the Zen GData service class and call it Blogger Service. From there, we're just going to go ahead and get a list of all the user's current blogs. So we create a new query. This URL just happens to be the Blogger MetaFeed, which lists all of the blogs available for a user. This is documented on code.google.com. And then we go and use the Blogger service to go and fetch that feed. From there, we just go and extract the first blog, since that's all we care about right now. And we get the title, the blog's URL, and the URL of the feed for that blog. Something to note here is that title, while you'd normally think of it as a string, is actually an XML element, and as such, it can have various attributes. So you need to be sure to actually request the text for the title as opposed to anything else that might be there. And this applies to any other extension element as well. Right, and then we're just going to go ahead and print this out. So if we load this in our browser, you can see that it's successfully fetched the first blog. And if I load it, there's the index page. And that looks good. So let's go ahead and do something a little more interesting. Let's go and actually fetch all the blog posts available on this blog. So, again, we construct a new query, and we use the blog feed URL that we extracted earlier. We then, again, use the service to go and fetch this feed, and then we iterate through every single entry in this feed, and here, every entry represents a blog post. For each blog post, we go and extract the URL from the blog post and the title, and display them on screen in a list. So if we refresh the page again, you'll see it successfully fetched all the blog posts available. So now that that's done, let's go and insert some new posts into the blog. So I'm just going to go and create a form down here. This is just a normal post to the exact same page we're on right now. It has two inputs, a text field named title, and a text area named body. And you can see that right here. But right now this isn't wired up to do anything yet, so let's fix that. So right after we fetch the first blog, we'll check to see if there's anything in the form. If the form's completely empty, we won't do anything, but if there are things in the form, we'll go and create a brand new entry, populate the title and the content using title and content extension elements, and then just grab the title and the body from the post, and then use the service class to insert that into the blog using insert entry. If we save this one more time, and then switch back to the browser, I go ahead and type in a title here, so hello world, this is my sample post, and hit continue. You'll see that the post appears in the list. If I reload the blog's index, it appears there. And if I click on the post right here, it takes us to the page dedicated to that post. If you want to learn more, check out the PHP Getting Started guide that accompanies this video. The URL is on your screen. The Zen Framework manual contains in-depth information about working with Zen Framework modules, including this one. You can find this at framework.zen.com/manual. Finally, be sure to keep the Zen Framework API reference I mentioned earlier on hand, available at framework.zen.com/api-doc/core. I hope you got a good idea how to get started. Thank you for watching, and happy coding.